In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Give strength to your servant and save the child of your handmaid. Turn to me and have mercy on me. Certainly our psalm today captures the intensity of Hagar's prayer. Her son was the son of the chieftain, Abraham himself. But suddenly they had been cast out, Hagar and Ishmael, with just a loaf of bread and a skin of water in the wilderness of Beersheba. Was it noon? Was it three? At any rate, the bread and water were gone, and they had not seen a soul to pick them up and take them in, or even a lone date tree planted by a well of water. Only mirages. Give ear, O Lord, to my prayer and attend to the voice of my supplications. We first meet Hagar in Genesis chapter 16. We find there that she is the personal servant of Sarah, who was Abraham's wife, and that she's originally from Egypt. God had promised Abraham that his descendants would be like the stars, but this was way before our story last week where Abraham says that Sarah will have a son. In fact, it's about 10 years before. So when Sarah hears this promise that Abraham is going to have many descendants, she's a little worried, seeing that she herself cannot have children. Where were these descendants going to come from? In this culture, it was the custom that if a woman could not have children, she could choose another woman to give to her husband so that he could have children for her. So Sarah decides to give Abraham her slave Hagar so that he can have his descendants. We don't know that much about Hagar, but since she was the personal slave of Sarah, it is possible that she came from a very wealthy family in Egypt, and that she had been captured as a young girl and then sold as a slave. But she was still, in any case, once Hagar became pregnant, she began to despise Sarah and feel that she was above her. But she was still Sarah's slave, and Sarah was able to make her life very miserable. So miserable that Hagar fled into the desert. As she was resting by a spring of water, the angel of the Lord met her, and he told her to go back to Sarah and submit to her. After all, she needed the care that the tribe was able to provide if she was going to live and carry this child. Then he gives her the same promise that he gave Abraham. I will multiply your descendants until they are a great multitude, which no one can count. He tells her to name her son Ishmael, which means God sees, because God had seen her misery. With this promise, Hagar returns and submits to Sarah. Ishmael is born and raised as the heir to Abraham's tribe. But 12 years later, Isaac is born. And then we have our story today. At the party for Isaac's weaning, he might have been about four, maybe even five. Sarah sees Ishmael teasing Isaac, and all her fears and insecurities descend upon her. Who knew when Abraham would die? Would the tribe really accept her little boy Isaac, as cute as he was, as the legitimate heir instead of this strapping teenager? They have got to go, Sarah tells Abraham. And Abraham is distressed, which I'm glad to see that he was distressed. He does love Ishmael. But God agrees with Sarah and assures Abraham that God will take care of Ishmael and Hagar. So Abraham hardens his heart and sends Hagar and Ishmael away with only the provisions that they can carry on their back. But God does take care of Hagar. When the water runs out and she is at the last moment in despair, knowing that they would die, he sends an angel to her and assures her that she will not die, that God is taking care of them, and that Ishmael will become a father of many nations. He then shows them where they can find water, and they can fill up their water skin. In fact, these many nations, the Arab people, trace their descendants, trace their ancestor back to Ishmael. So in a way, it has happened. And the end of the story, we don't see here, but in later on in Genesis, we do see that Ishmael and Isaac meet once again at Abraham's death, and they help bury him together. This is a rather strange story, and hopefully far away from any of our experiences, but what can the Holy Spirit show us through these readings? I can think of two points. One, from the perspective of Abraham and Sarah. I know that in my own life, and probably many of you as well, there have been times when I have hurt people. Sometimes it has been deliberate, coming from my own fears and insecurities. And then other times I've been caught in the system, or I just am unable to help this person that is in need, and I feel that I really wish I could, but I can't. One thing we can learn is that God is present in these situations, even though we may feel that we're far from him. God is present and still loves us, even when we're in the wrong. God still loved Abraham. God still loved Sarah. And God called Abraham to be, even though he had to let Sarah Hagar go, he called him to be an intercessor. And I think that we too, when we realize the wrong we have done, or we know we can't help, but we can ask God to take care of these people, this person that we have hurt, and to heal them, and to work in their lives for good, doing what we ourselves cannot do. And then from the perspective of Hagar, there are times in our lives when the very people that should be taking care of us turn against us, hurt and reject us. Sometimes it's because of the gospel, because of our calling, but even in times when it isn't, there are times when those we trust turn against us. Like Hagar, we can come to the end where we feel just desperation, and that nothing can be done. We're at the end of our rope. The readings today tell us that God is with us, even at these times, even in these desert places. God wants to help us, and when we connect with him, when we call upon him, he can show us the way, show us that well of water that will be able to take us to the next step. We will be reading through Genesis throughout the summer, and I am hoping, I'm looking forward to looking at these different stories. The culture there is very strange to us in many ways. And yet, these people, just like us, were trying to find God in their life and how it all fits together and who God was. And so, I think that we can learn from them, because we too are faced challenges and wonder at times, okay, where is God in the midst of this? Who is God? Who do I believe God to be? Hagar and Ishmael would probably agree with Jesus' words that sometimes the ways of God do not bring peace, and that one's enemies can be the members of one's own household. But Jesus assures us that God is aware of our situation. God's attention reaches even down to those sparrows that play among the sunflowers or out your window. And God knows your situation down to the hairs of your head. So, even in those desert places, we can pray with the psalmist, "Show me a sign of your favor, so that those who hate me may see it and be ashamed, because you, O Lord, have helped me and comforted me."